So, finally arrived. If you follow me on Twitter, I've been waiting for this mini PC here for 3 weeks, thanks to a seller that's very frequent that happens to me now on AliExpress that lies. They give you fake tracking numbers. They didn't have stock of the 2.5-inch model that I originally wanted to get. And instead of just being honest and truthful with me, they didn't come out with the facts. They didn't say, oh, look, we don't have it in stock. You're going to have to wait for 2 or 3 weeks. No, they gave me a fake tracking number. They gave me all these stories about it being held up by DHL Customs. Anyway, it is finally here. That seller, by the way, is Haitotsu. I think that's how you pronounce it. They're the guys that make these mini PCs. Now, I reviewed the fanless i7-7500U mini PC. Wasn't bad at all. I used that for quite a few, almost actually 2 years or so, and I decided to sell that one because I just wanted something with more power. So this has an i5-8250U, 3.8 gigahertz maximum single core turbo, or it can run all four cores at 3.4, depending on the thermal and power limits and things like that. So the same CPU that's in the Xiaomi Mi Notebook Pro. Now I reviewed this recently, which is Intel's Nuke. This is the Gemini Lake, and it's not a bad little mini PC, but of course this is on the real low end performance wise. This should be a nice step up. It's got HDMI 2.0, which is another feature that attracted me towards this, and it cost me just $329. So the box here suggests that there's three different models. I know of the i5 model and the i7. So the i7, that one's the 8550U. So another CPU that you will see commonly in notebooks because it's 15 watts. That one turbos up to 4.0 gigahertz. It's going to be faster, but only slightly. But in my test of the i7 Mi Notebook Pro, I found out that it wasn't really actually that much faster for multi-core performance and video encoding and things like that. Okay, so this is the brand here. So it's the Haitotsu. That was the seller too that I got it from AliExpress. But yeah, not happy, as I mentioned, about how long they took to ship this out and the fact that they lied to me. That's the big issue I'm having at the moment with a lot of sellers. So they've given us a driver CD here. Well, it's actually a DVD. I don't even know if I have a DVD, a portable one, around. So check the accessories first. And here we have, HDMI cable, good to see. And we've got some, it looks like, what's that right there? Little rubber feet. Okay, screws and little rubber feet. And something else is in here. Perhaps I'll, should be the power cable, power charger. All right, EU style cable with the figure eight style plug, which is good. These are very easy to get hold of. And this will be the power adapter. So hopefully it's not too big. And the size there actually looks all right. 19 volts, 3.42 amps. So that's the same actually as Intel's Nuke, the Gemini Lake I looked at. So here's the mini PC. I just pulled it out of the plastic wrap and it surprised me because it's a lot shorter than I thought it would be, even though it is missing that 2.5 inch drive, that bay for it. This is the size of it here. So the height of it next to the Intel Nuke, this is the Gemini Lake J4005 that I just recently reviewed. You can see there's quite a height difference there. The Intel has a much better build to it, the quality of it. The frame of this one is plastic, however, it just feels really solid. This one has a metal frame around it. So right here at the front, we've got a 3.5mm headphone jack, USB 3 port, power button there on the top. This top here is just like a shiny plastic, made to look like glass. And you'll see we've got another two ports here, so USB 3, USB 2. And the rear of it, where we've got everything really going on here. So you've got a display port, HDMI 2.0. Whoops, what just happened there? No, the bottom has fallen out of it. Okay, it's not even screwed in place. That's why we've got those screws in the box. A gigabit LAN, DC in there. And then, of course, a USB 2 port and that Type-C port. So this is the vent. All the hot air is going to come out of this. Hopefully, this is not going to be noisy. I'm not very fond of fan noise, so hopefully this is going to be quite tame when it comes to fan noise under full load. And oh, there is actually a little Kensington lock slot there. And on the side, just a little vent. A little hard to see because it's very dark. Paint job of this. Now, there is one thing that's missing, I think. We should have a micro SD card slot on this, or an SD card slot, I feel. But you can probably use, of course, one of those USB ports for that. So taking a look at the internals, right here is our NVMe slot. This is also SATA 3. Now you're going to have to use the 22x80 spec drives because the screw is placed for that particular size, not any shorter. They could have maybe put something in here, but you can see there's actually some resistors and things there on the tiny little circuit board that this has. Build quality looks good. Not bad at all. You can see there's the battery plugged in there. That's for the BIOS. So if you needed to reset the BIOS, the easiest thing to do would just pull out the power and then pull out this plug here, which of course is retaining that information in the BIOS. So there's the two double data rate 4 RAM slots. That RAM just slots and then clips down in place. Typical laptop RAM. Now, one thing I don't like what they've done here. Can you see this? The antennas for the wireless AC card, they've glued them in place. So that's going to make it tricky to swap and use your own tiny little, it's M.2 card. Now I just removed the motherboard to have a look at the fan. So it's a little 5-volt fan that they've put in here. And you can see there's some cables that attach to the lid here. That's why the lid's plastic, because this is for the wireless AC antenna reception and Bluetooth. So it's a little tricky, but you will be able to clean this, do maintenance on this. If it does fall with dust, then you should be able to blow all that out. You just got to remove 2 screws and then flip out the motherboard. So I got lucky and I managed to pick that glue off and use my own faster 9260 wireless AC card. And the last thing to install, of course, is your SSD. Now it's time for me to set up Windows 10, get that installed here from a USB pen drive. And from here on in, I'll be using a capture card. So I got Windows 10 all set up. It was really, really quick. It surprised me. It did not take long at all to install it, get myself up and running. So far running well. I can hear the fan. It's pretty much constantly on at the moment. Now I've got some bad news and some good news. The bad news is the BIOS is pretty much fully locked out to us. You can disable secure boot, you can change the boot order, but there's no advanced settings. But the good news is I've installed Intel's XTU here, and yes, we can tweak up the power limits. Now, why would you want to do this? Well, basically what you can do is tweak the power limits here and get this Core i5-8250U to perform very similar, if not better, than the i7-7700HQ quad core. That means it's gonna basically hold the turbos here, as you can see, 3.6 megahertz across all 4 cores. It's been able to hold that for about 20 minutes continuously without any issues. Now temperatures, max temperatures, I have seen it peak at about 78 degrees here. So it is getting hot. And as mentioned, the fan is probably the con so far. So we have a look now in HW info, a little bit more information about the CPU. So it's the Kaby Lake R. It has 4 cores, 8 threads, and you can see the features of it all listed right here for us. And the graphics, of course, is the Intel UHD 620. So exactly the same chipset in the Mi Notebook Pro that I reviewed here. And I just wanted to point out a couple of other things. So the wireless card that I installed, that's working fine. I just had to get the drivers for it, even though it's not really listing it here properly. Now, maximum link speed, that's not actually correct. I'm getting really good speeds out of this card. I don't know why it's listing 260. So far for me, the wireless range, because I'm about 2-3 rooms away with some concrete walls and things like that away from my actual router. And you can see down the bottom here that I do have the full signal strength there, so I'm not running into any issues with that. So I'm going to run a couple of benchmarks here. This is just my initial first impressions unboxing video. So here's the speed of the Samsung 960 Evo. So no problems here. It's running at full speed. This is a very fast drive, so great to have this option, but no bottlenecks. So SATA 3 limits us to about 550 megabytes read and write. So if you went with a SATA 3 drive, just bear in mind that it's not going to be as fast. So one more benchmark just to quickly look at. This is Cinebench R15. So we ran the OpenGL benchmark and it's 56 frames per second average. So this is about 30-35 frames per second on average, less than the dedicated NVIDIA MX150 GPU that is often paired up with this particular CPU. The CPU score, 579 CB. This isn't bad, but remember, I have the power limits pretty much increased and disabled, well, up to 45 watts, so it can use really all the power it wants. So it should actually be over 700 CB, but it seems to be running into some current limiting. So not power limiting, but current limiting, and that's limiting it a little bit. So that's really about the best we're going to get out of this. For video work and things like that, it's not looking as good as, for example, my Mi Notebook Pro, where the same exact CPU with a 35 watt power limit can get around 700 CB. So we'll test out one game. This is Fortnite running in 720p on the lowest setting, 60 frames per second. So this is actually running a lot better than I thought it would. I suppose I should actually jump out. Right, it is dipping down to 40 frames per second, 39 here. So you want to keep it on that low setting. You can see that already. So when I was gaming there, it did peak up to 84 degrees, but of course I do have that increased power limit. So if that's lower than probably expect, a lot less than this. Now the fan noise is probably the con so far, that it is a little bit irritating. It's on. You can probably hear it just in the background here. Now performance and things like Chrome and all that, it's really fast. I mean, this is a Core i5. This is really good, the performance so far that I'm seeing out of this particular little mini PC. It's got a lot of power packed into such a small portable little package. So a 4K 60 frames per second streaming test, and this is handling it just fine. No problems. It's dropping a few frames here, but that's just when you go to the full screen size, it tends to do that. You see, just dropped a couple then. So overall, this performance is really good. Of course, the wireless card's keeping up. Depends all on the connection you have. And it also will play natively HEVC codec files, VP9, things like that. It's not a problem for 8th generation Intel Core i5 CPUs. Okay, so there we go. So far, the pros of this. This has got a lot of power when you think of the size of this. It's very, very small. It's the size of the Apollo Lake, Gemini Lake mini PCs you get from Intel, the Nukes. In fact, it's actually a little bit smaller. Now, you can get one of these with the 2.5-inch drive bay. That's the model I originally wanted because my plan was then to add a 1 or 2 terabyte hard drive for backing up files on there. So as a media PC, I think it's going to be great for that because it can handle 4K just fine, and 4K 60 hertz because it does have that HDMI 2.0 port. You've got display out. You can run in theory up to 2 monitors for sure, maybe even 3 there. Now there is a few cons here. The one that, okay, when you increase the power limits, it's going to boost the performance, but I've noticed that it will still run into some sort of current limit, and I think it's connected to the little tiny power supply, so it's probably asking for too much. The power supply cannot keep up with the current, so that's why it's not performing as good as, say, my Xiaomi Mi Notebook Pro when I removed the current limits, the power limits on that one. You could get a Cinebench R15 score of over 700, but not the case here. But even so, the performance of this, it's very, very fast, again, considering the size of this mini PC. That is really good. So the biggest con would be the fan noise. So it's, at the moment, you can hear it. You can probably, hang on, just hold it up towards the mic I've got here. That's the kind of fan noise you're going to have to expect when it's running. And it's slightly irritating. When it's running at 100%, it does pick up a little bit. But if you've got it behind a TV or a monitor or something like that, then you won't hear it as much there. The other con, of course, it does not have that 2.5-inch drive slot. I wish all models had that. But the other one is no SD card slot. There's no mics on this for Windows Cortana. And it doesn't have optical audio out, which some people may like. I've got HDMI out, and you can do your HDMI audio pass through with the cable, at least to do that. So that's just the preview there of it. I hope to see you back later with a possible second video, the full review. I'm going to be using this now at home for the next week or 2 weeks or so before I do any update videos. Thank you so much for watching, and subscribe to the channel because I will have the Gemini Lake, the new Pentium Silver J5500 that will be featured in the channel. Oh, and almost forgot, Linux support. Yes, it will run Linux. I've tested it so far and it's running everything just fine.